I think I first got this sense that Johns Hopkins was a really integral part of the history of resuscitation when I was at Duke. And I did one of my very first talks on the history of resuscitation. And I found a very clean copy of the article. It's very helpful for my talk. And then I came to Hopkins and I was giving another talk on the history of CPR and came here to the stacks. And this is what I found, this original copy of the Cowan-Hovind, Jude, and Knickerbocker paper, and just brings tears to my eyes. It's been handled so frequently, and you can clearly see that at Hopkins it's a really important part of our history.
Certainly the most impressive and important event was the publication of the paper in JAMA 50 years ago, showing that in patients for the first time, if you compress the chest in a regular rhythmic way, you provide enough blood flow so that you can go get a defibrillator and ultimately defibrillate a patient with ventricular tachycardia or fibrillation and save their life.
The history of CPR really involves five key gentlemen, and that's Dr. Cowan-Hovind, who is a retired department chair of engineering who started a lab in Dr. Blaylock's Department of Surgery. He had a young guy, Knickerbocker, working with him, and they were trying to discover how to defibrillate through the chest. And as they were becoming successful with this, they made this observation that pressing on the chest with these paddles may in fact raise the blood pressure.
When they put the paddles on, a guy noticed that there was an increase. He put the paddles on each side of the chest. He noticed that there was an increase in blood pressure.
And rather than just ignoring that, because that's not what they were funded to do, he was curious about that and he followed up on that, and they started as a team to think about if pressing on the chest might actually perfuse the organs. And that led to this famous moment about the elevator story that I've discovered when I was talking to them, where Dr. Knickerbocker apparently was working in the lab one day, and this dog was not supposed to have a cardiac arrest at that moment, and it did. And they wanted to save the dog, but they knew they needed electricity because that was the part of the research they did know. And they knew that they needed to apply the electricity within 5 minutes or the dog would die. And so he asked his colleague to press on the chest, what we now call chest compressions. He didn't know what it would do, but he said, just keep pressing, I'll be back. And he literally ran down the stairs from the 12th floor of what's now called Blaylock, and he went all the way down to 5.
Made my way down, hastened pretty fast down the stairwell, down to the heart station, got the defibrillator, rolled it to the elevator, pushed the button, and waited.
Anybody that knows the Blaylock elevators knows that you have to wait and wait, and he did. And he doesn't know, but he thinks it was close to 20 minutes, and he finally gets upstairs, and they're still pressing on the chest. And really, the dog should not revive because they've never had a dog live more than 6 minutes. And he applies the defibrillator, and the dog immediately revives, and the next day is completely back to himself. And that was their aha moment. It's not what their research was supposed to be, but they discovered that, you know, chest compressions perfuses the heart and can keep the, as he says, it slows the dying process and gives you a chance to get them back. So Dr. Jude, who was working down the hallway on some other research, started talking to him about this, and he was an actual physician who was able to translate this. He was able to take this lab work into the actual clinical environment and save lives clinically.
I think at the same time as we were doing this with the cardiac, the mouth-to-mouth resuscitation was being done at the Baltimore City Hospitals by Peter Safar and Jim Eun. That's why you have the pulmonary and CPR, otherwise it would just be CR.
There's a story that Fire Chief McMahon had been invited to the Peter Safar's lab and shown how to do mouth-to-mouth to patients in the real world who'd had, for instance, a drowning. And then he was also invited over to the cardiac arrest lab and shown this chest compression component. And we understand that they met, and that's how this concept of CPR came together. It's a classic story from Johns Hopkins. There are different people from anesthesia, from surgery, from engineering, all working together and coming up with this key concept of CPR and helping us save lives. And here we are 50 years later.
The thing is, the bottom hand up, off the man's chest, you get a good precise pressure.
The American Heart and American Red Cross have been instrumental in advocating that the public should do and perform CPR and in training the public to do CPR. The next logical step was to produce a device that would be easy for the public to use to actually definitively provide defibrillation. So in the mid-1990s, industry decided to produce these devices, and the American Heart Association promoted the notion that these should be applied and tested in the public theater. There were several studies that showed very clearly you could have a layperson defibrillate and have the person survive. And then the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute sponsored a randomized clinical trial in public sites that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine about 6 years ago that showed that if you compare sites with people, volunteers who were trained at defibrillators and had a defibrillator, there was better survival than in sites where they just called 911 and did CPR. That it does go back to Jude Kuvanova and Knickerbocker and Knickerbocker's interest in defibrillation. And I can assure you that Guy Knickerbocker Kuvanova never conceived of the idea back then that a layperson would actually do this definitive job of giving a definitive shock to a patient in order to cure their cardiac arrest.
See, this is the next advance in CPR. Because this is basically like a big blood pressure cuff. You see, this is a bladder, and then this is an inflation system here.
Unfortunately, the overall survival rate of the 250,000 people who have a cardiac arrest today is only 8%. Only 8% of those people survive to leave the hospital alive with reasonable neurologic function. So there's a lot that we hope we can do to improve the way we do CPR, the frequency and the technique, and bring in new and exciting ideas to improve outcomes.
Here at Hopkins, we're trying to take the classic teaching of CPR, but move it into the next generation. Sure, we want you to learn CPR on your knees in case somebody drops in front of you at the airport, but we also want you to learn to work in a team of 10 to 15 people. We think the simulation lab is making it much more realistic, helping them understand how to put it all together better than the kind of classic curriculum.
In the last few years, the most important addition, in my view, to routine CPR and this issue of defibrillation is the use of in-hospital hypothermia.
What we've learned from CPR and resuscitation is that we can restart organs and organ systems after they failed. With the recent success in therapeutic hypothermia, it's almost like a suspended animation state to limit the injury of the brain, the heart, and every organs of the body. But the next step here, which is even more crucial in my mind, is to figure out how the brain restarts and how do we protect that mechanism. After an injury or even during sleep, the cortex needs to be awakened. So there's an alarm system here that comes out from the subcortical area. With therapeutic hypothermia, what it does is it allows us to protect many aspects of this, and that's what we're trying to do in my laboratory. It is up to future researchers and current researchers to actually find the most appropriate means to channel this discovery to actually create and establish the best possible outcome in patients. So it may not be therapeutic hypothermia, it may be something else in the near future, but in principle, we already have proof that the brain can recover to a certain degree, and it is up to the future work to allow us to make the brain, to facilitate the brain recovery to where it was before cardiac arrest.
So it's a technique that took off 50 years ago, which has been exploited extensively in the last 50 years, and has made a major impact on human health.